Recognizing patterns and applying them in new situations may be two key features of language and thought. But what happens when the pattern's wrong? Last time I pulled out a critter you've never seen before, a schwuff, and I think we agreed that we'd immediately know what to say if I had five or six of them. But that's not thanks to the schwuff so much as it is to our understanding of plurals. There's a paradigm for plurals in English, and it works for words big and small, short and long. So we have reason to be pretty confident that this is just how plurals work in English. Then eventually we run into some word that doesn't fit the paradigm. We've abstracted and analogized this general idea about plurals, but its inadequacy is staring us in the face. This roadblock is not just a problem for the grammar of English plurals. If you ever had to fight your way through some basic logic before, you noticed that we use general statements like all this or every that to draw conclusions. But just like with mice and alumni, we're always at risk of running smack into something that doesn't fit with the general statement we've worked so hard to abstract and apply by analogy. If you were living in the 1700s and your name were David Hume, you would have pushed this point very hard, wondering why from this experience we form any conclusion beyond those past instances of which we have had experience. This gets called the problem of induction, and it asks us frankly why we should have predicted that the plural of mouse would be mouses just because the plurals of other words end in an S. Of course, if I'm learning English, this seems like a fairly trivial event. I note the exception, I hope that I remember it next time, and I move on. But not all failed applications of paradigms are this mundane. Nassim Nicholas Taleb uses the metaphor of the black swan. Swans are white, not black, or so Europeans thought until British ornithologist John Latham stumbled across real-life black swans in Australia. The black swan has since become a mascot for rare events that have a surprisingly huge impact. These abnormalities strike us as obvious after the fact, just as obvious as it is to an English speaker that mice is the plural of mouse, and to modern avian enthusiasts that not all swans are white. We can of course incorporate this new information and maybe even be a little smarter with our paradigm by hedging against big unknowns. But can we go the other way? Let's turn to plurals just one more time. Children might get corrected for saying mouses, sure, and they might step in line. But at some point, English-speaking children applied this same paradigm incorrectly, but instead of incorporating the correction, they grew up to overturn old norms. Sometimes we simplify, other times we preserve the irregularity, and there's even room for creativity as brand new patterns emerge. As we learn about language and thought, and use thought and language to learn, exceptions to the rule can give us some useful feedback about the patterns we think we see.